What's up, YouTube? Welcome back. I am outside today. It is actually just a few days after Christmas, so I hope all you guys had a happy holiday. And yeah, I'm in a short sleeve shirt. It has been in the 60s, which is not good for me because that means all the seeds. I want to plant all of the things because the weather feels like spring. And I obviously can't do that. So I'm going through and getting a really detailed list of what I'm wanting to plant. So I thought I'd share with you guys some of those things. I plan on making a video in the future. We are doing a lot of greens this year on our farm. So I'm going to save that for a totally different video because there's so many greens that we're growing this year for so many different purposes that I'll just dive into that later. So I just wanted to hit, though, a few of my favorite tomatoes that I grew last year. And I'm going to tell you why they're my favorite and why they made it back on our grow list. And then something else that I'm growing a lot of this year, not even for me at all. I mean, maybe a couple plants, but all the nasturtiums. I do several plant sales in the spring. And without a doubt, I sell out of my nasturtiums like the first thing. These just do really good because they're so versatile on how you can grow them. And you know, a lot of people can grow them in their apartments, on their balcony. So they're just super versatile. I got a lot of different, I think I just grew maybe the orange last year. So I just got a lot of different of these, different ones of these. They're edible flowers, if, for those of you that don't know. And they're beautiful. You eat the green part. So these are making my grow list. I'm hoping to incorporate some of these in our garden, but mainly these are just starts that I plan on doing to sell. So just thought I'd throw that in for free. And now our tomatoes. So this one actually made my grow list, but I have not grown it. So last year was kind of an experimental year for us on the farm. I grew around 70 different varieties of tomatoes, large and cherries. Never had done that before. It was quite ambitious, if I'm being honest. But I just really wanted to experiment with a bunch of new things to see what I liked, what I didn't, what sold well, and what didn't. Those of you who've been following our journey, you guys probably know that we do garden for ourselves. However, we do sell to a couple restaurants and a few other venues. So that's something that is different. Like when I'm looking to grow, it's not just, yes, it does it taste good, but I'm also looking at how fast it ripens on the vine. Does it split? Like all these different things that make it appealable to a buyer. So those are just some things that like I have to think of differently. So it gave me a good idea of what sold really well last year and what didn't. These came recommended to me by a friend, and it is the Kellogg's Breakfast. I've heard that this is a really good slicer, so I am going to go ahead and add that. I told myself I was not going to add very many new varieties to the farm this year just because I did a lot of that last year, but she said this was really, really good, so I'm going to go ahead and grow that one again, or grow that one for the first time. The Paul Robinson, I actually like this enough to where it is going to make the grow list again. However, it was not one of my favorites, which was kind of surprising because I have lots of friends who've grown this one and it is a definite regrow for them. It did well. However, it did not produce a lot. So it didn't yield a lot of fruit. It's a medium size, definitely not a large slicer. And it hung in like a lot of my other tomato plants. Got aphids mid-season because our soil had lots of nitrogen in them, and this plant in particular never got affected by that, so that was nice that it didn't have any pest issues. So I am going to grow it again, and I'm going to try it again and see how it does, just because the taste really was good, and it was a good for a medium size. It was really nice. Let me move my cherries somewhere else. Let's see here. This is an awesome, and this is also another medium size that I will always grow. This one, the pink boar, was absolutely stunning. It has this beautiful like watermelon green color in it, and it's kind of speckled. I'm not sure if you guys can see. Some of you guys are probably familiar with these. This is a Wild Boar Farms variety that Baker Creek sells, and this thing, I wouldn't even say that it was a medium. It was kind of just a really large cherry. I mean, most of them averaged about, I don't know, that big. But these things kept going and kept going. I mean, they did phenomenal as far as just what the plant yielded. I planted two and I had so many. They were a great seller to me because they were so pretty that a lot of people wanted to buy them, like my restaurants and stuff. I had no problem selling these to my restaurants. Great flavor. Definitely recommend you guys put this on your grow list. I will continue to grow this one probably every year from here on out. So the Dr. Witchies, White Cheese, however you say it, this is a orange slicer. I can't say enough. This will probably be the third year I've grown these. I do not really like acidic tomatoes, which is why I really, really like this one. It's not really acidic at all. And all the fruit that it does yield is like all of mine weighed over a pound. So it was just really reliable for a slicer because I knew it was going to produce really fat, juicy tomatoes, which was also really good. And for a yellow variety or for an orange variety, it was, this one's by far just my favorite. So let's see. We have got the Granny Cantrell German Red. These I grew last year for the first time. This was a new variety. I also always grow these. Almost all of my tomatoes off of these plants, I think I grew three of these plants, were all over 2 pounds. Every single. And they were just the deepest red. When you think of a classic tomato sandwich, this one came to mind. I sold so many of these. Had no problem getting rid of them. Just good. Had no pest problems out of them at all. I mean, but the fruit, I guess my only complaint would be that it yielded such large fruits that I was having to go in with like produce bags and tie them all up, which really isn't a complaint. But these things did phenomenal. Cannot say enough good things about those. And then the German Johnson, it's a really deep red too. Again, it just kept on producing. I remember towards the end of the season, I was trying to make room for fall planting. So I ended up just having to rip these out. And like, it was September. And I know we just had a really good year with tomatoes. I mean, a lot of surrounding farms had already ripped up their tomatoes. They were done. And I was still just like, these things would not die. They just kept producing. This one, very, very flavorful. Also yielded, I mean, most of these were a pound, if not greater. So that was really good. And one thing I've just had to learn too, especially if you're wanting to try to grow tomatoes to sell, just pick them at the first sign of color. You don't, like for me, I'm going to wait until they're good and ripe, and then I'm going to come out here and I'm going to pick it and I'm going to go inside and cut up a good juicy tomato. You can't do that when you're selling them, because when you pick them when they're at their prime, they're going to split, they're going to rot soon. And if you're not immediately like delivering, which we deliver like an hour or so away from where we farm, it just, they end up just not doing well. So you really, like, if you're wanting to grow tomatoes just to sell, first signs of color, you need to pick them, and they can let them ripen before they do anything with them, which I know kind of stinks, but that's just really, I've tried it both ways, and that is just the way that's more effective for selling. This one, tomato hillbilly potato leaf. This is a beautiful, like, red, yellow, orange streak tomato. This one's beautiful. I had like, I don't know, I have such a bittersweet feeling with this, although it did make the grow list again. So yielded ridiculously large fruits. I mean, all of mine were over 2 pounds. They were good, juicy, what you would want, like just a, not really acidic, just a really like kind of sweet with a hint of acid. Really, really good. However, all of these, so the leaves on these are weird. They don't look like a tomato. They look like a potato leaf, which is where they get the name from. I had so many pest problems with these, though. All of these in the beginning had so many aphids, it was not even funny. Now, I don't know, because I, you know, later did find out that my soil was containing a lot of nitrogen, which does create an aphid problem. I don't know if that was part of it, but I know that these plants in particular had, like, probably double or triple the amount of aphids as some of my other plants. So I don't know, I'm gonna try it again just because the tomatoes were so good and they produced so much. But that is something to be mindful of, that maybe plant some like companion thing in there that's you know, repellent towards that, which is probably what I'll do. I'll probably put some herbs in between or around this plant to try to help prevent the pest problem that I had. But they still just produce so good that I can't not grow them again. Did that one. Goodness. Okay. This will be, and there are a few more new ones I'm going to add, but the white Thomasol, I hope I'm saying that right. This is a beautiful cream white tomato. It tasted fantastic. And for me, so it says that these weigh about 8 ounces each. That's probably true. I had some on the smaller size, and then sometimes I would get a big one that was like, you know, a really large variety. But this one was so good for the fact, like, selling it. I have a restaurant that I sell to that does German food. So for them, they really like the exotic tomatoes. They really like things that are different and unorthodox. So it works really well for me to grow kind of crazy varieties because they buy them because they're different and they like that. So this one tasted good. I didn't really have any pest problems. It did great. I grew like 4 or 5 of these plants. And then I had a really, really good time getting rid of them. Like, it was not very hard for me to get rid of these at all. So I will definitely start these again. I do recommend, though, just a little tidbit, if you're doing plant sales, be mindful that a lot of people aren't wanting to buy all these different exotic heirloom varieties at plant sales. They usually have something in mind, what they're used to getting at a, you know, Lowe's or a co-op or something like that. So I grew up 60, 70 something varieties last year, and I took a lot of those varieties to plant sales. I also spent a lot of my time trying to explain what they were comparable to, what that variety was. I like growing all the colorful and crazy things and trying new things. However, that's not the case with everyone. So just be mindful, and this is something I've had to reshift. Like, this year, I'm not growing, I mean, I'll grow an orange slicer and probably like the white one again, but I got just Cherokee Purple, and this is what I will start to sell because everyone asked me. I didn't even start any Cherokee Purples last year because I just didn't have any desire to, but it's just what sells, and I hate that because I want people to try new things. But I've just learned that I probably would have done a lot better last season had I just grown things that people were used to. And then a black cream, which is also very comparable to a Cherokee Purple. I'm going to grow this too. People are familiar with this variety. And then just your classic beefsteak. I will probably start several and several of these. I didn't grow any of these last year. It has been years since I've grown just a classic beefsteak tomato. I think once you start experimenting and you start, like, just getting to witness how great a tomato can be and how versatile it can be, you really just don't want to do just a boring beefsteak tomato. However, it is a staple to a lot of people, especially here in the South. So this is when I've decided to bite my tongue and realize I'm going to have to grow it because all of my people want it. So this one's making the start list. I'm growing it to sell. I do not know that any of these will end up in my garden, but we'll see. And then just some cherry tomatoes. This is the Blue Gold Berries. It's also a Wild Boar Farm variety. These things were gorgeous and they did so well. I had no problem selling these whatsoever. They were really thick skinned, which is great for when you're selling and you're just, I mean, I would come and get, I'm not even exaggerating, like 5 gallon buckets full at a time. I mean, these things did great. They tasted great. They look pretty in salads. They're easy to sell. Definitely recommend those. And then the tomato red fig. These as starts are fantastic. They had really thick stalks. I didn't really have any pest problems with them. They were super prolific. They're also very sweet. A lot of people use these to make preserves out of. So I will grow these again. I will not start as many. However, they will make it into my garden because they just tasted really, really good. It kind of tasted like candy and my kids ate them. Berries Crazy Cherries. Another one of those I have a love-hate relationship with. I will grow these. I will grow these to sell these. So these are one of those things. I started a lot of these because I heard really good things about them. They grow in clusters, so you can literally like cut off a whole like cluster of them, which is really nice. If you pick them when they're still kind of green, they taste not good at all. If you wait until they're like really, really really yellow, they taste really sweet, really, really good. I can't even tell you how many of these I sold. However, they, like, it's wild. I've never really seen anything like it. I grew 2 of these last year in our own garden, and they were these massive, like, bushes. I've never seen so many cherry tomatoes in my entire life. So I liked that they were so prolific. However, I also got really overwhelmed at how there was just so many of them, and lots of times I didn't even know what I was going to do with them. There were so many of them. But obviously, it's making it back on the grow list. I'm only going to grow one this time, and I'm going to give it sufficient space to be able to do what it needs to do. And I mean, I even trimmed this thing back several times, and it just kept on going. Here are some varieties of the bumblebees. So last year, I only grew the pink bumblebee, which was great. It's this beautiful red and yellow streaked tomato. It was also had really thick skin, so it didn't split hardly ever. Grew so many of them. It's much bigger than you would think, so it's like a pretty good sized cherry tomato. Really pretty on salads, really easy to sell and get rid of. So I had such good luck with this last year. Last season, I grew, I think, maybe three plants that I went ahead and got the sunrise bumblebee, which is beautiful. And then they make a purple bumblebee, which is a little bit darker. Instead of the yellow streaks, it's more like a green purple streak. So I'm excited to do all these just because they were really, really hardy tomatoes. I had no issues out of these plants, didn't have any pests. I just really cannot speak highly enough about these at all. And then I grew the blue cream berries. These were also so beautiful. And I'm telling you guys, if you're wanting to try to market garden and, you know, grow food to sell, the look matters a lot. So these were such a good pop of color that I had no problem getting rid of these at all. They taste really good, heat tolerant. You know, some of my cherries, even though tomatoes love heat, some of mine just, I think, too much heat. I mean, we're in Arkansas, so it gets really hot. These things just kept on putting out. I mean, I just, all of those I love. And the blueberries. So those were the blue cream berries. These are the blueberries. They're red and purple. Absolutely gorgeous. These are the kinds that I will probably, I don't foresee these ever going off of my grow list just because they did so good. I got so spoiled and I just don't want to chance it. So this year I'm actually not starting any new cherry tomato varieties. I really, really like the ones that I did, and these grew so well for me, and I sold them so well that I think this is probably it. Maybe a couple seasons down the road, I'll start experimenting again, but I just know that I can get rid of these. And since we're really trying to change our approach on our farm to be profitable, I'm just gonna stick with those this season and we'll go from there. And then I got several of these. It's the Brad's Atomic Grape. I will grow these for us and to sell. My husband absolutely loves these. They're his favorite cherry tomatoes. They're so pretty. They're like a purple, red, green. They're kind of oblong. I did have an issue with splitting. So again, here, be mindful of what growing zone you're in. But for me, something I just need to be mindful of is pick them before they're fully ripened, because a lot of them ended up splitting and then you have all those other issues. But as you guys can see, these are just some beautiful colored tomatoes. They taste fantastic. I will grow a lot of those. This is something else. Like I said, I'll do a more detailed video on all my greens and why I'm growing them and greens growing for profit and things like that. But this was just some of the things. And then this Tromboncino, which they call it a different, but it's a Tromboncino squash. This thing we had trellised up on a small trellis, and I had one start, and off of one plant, I can't even tell you how many Tromboncino squashes I got off of them. I mean, I encourage every single person, no matter what your growing zone is, grow one of these this year. They are so much fun. We are in the end of December. I still have these squashes in my pantry that I harvested in September. So you can harvest them and you can literally store them in a closet or a dark pantry or whatever for months, and they just don't go bad. I mean, we're still eating on squash that I grew this summer, which is wild. And it's fantastic. We would eat this stuff raw. We would put it, we'd season it up. I mean, it was just so versatile what you could do. I personally don't really like that, like, typical yellow squash taste. I don't know. I mean, I'll eat it. It's just not my favorite. So this was much more mild, which I really appreciated, and therefore it just seemed much versatile. a lot of mine got huge. If you guys follow me on Instagram, you'll see it. I've seen some pictures I've posted from the summer. I mean, these things were like as big as my kid. So that was really cool. It was a great conversation starter too. It's one of those things that I really liked telling someone, hey, why don't you go try this? Because it's one of those things that I really feel like if you just give it a shot, you might get overwhelmed by how it looks and it's funky. But it's one of those that if you grow it and you give it a shot, I think you would just be pleasantly surprised and then want to grow it again. So this year, I definitely recommend it being trellis. That just made more sense for us. And since they do grow so long, we had it to where it like ran on it. The plant got so big that it ended up running, you know, on the ground. And those, we had problems with them rotting off because of dew or if it rained or whatever. So I think trellising it on a good cattle panel, it can't be cheap, you know, like panels. It needs to be sturdy, heavy duty panels because they do get so big. The good thing about this one too is you can grow it all year round. You can grow it in the summer and it ends up being like that green color, or you can grow it in the winter right now and it will turn hard and look like a butternut squash. I've never actually grown them in the winter and the fall. However, I probably will do excuse me, I probably will do that next year. So those, my husband's like, just no question, will definitely always grow that. And surprisingly, I had no problem selling it. Typically what I did is, and anytime, this is also a good little tidbit that I've learned, anytime when I'm growing something really kind of funky like that, like the Armenian cucumbers, they're kind of funky. I would throw one in. So I have a restaurant that buys lots of tomatoes from me. And so I was like, hey, let me throw in this squash and you try it and see what you think. And if you like it, let me know. And they did. And then they ended up spending the rest of the season buying all of the squash. I mean, I would give them 50 pounds of squash a week. So that's really nice too. And I did that with the Armenian cucumber, like, hey, just try a couple, see what you think and let me know. So if that's something that you're growing something weird and you really don't know, just give them one to try and see what they say. I don't know that I'll grow the Armenian cucumbers again this year. I loved them. Like just the flavor was really, really good. We grew two plants on the ends of beds. I've just never seen cucumbers do that. I mean, I literally, which I had a baby in the mix of that too. So during like me having a baby and not coming out here every day and harvesting, there was literally like cucumbers as tall as I was. I mean, it was wild. But that was a good one to try. Hey, love. That was a good one to try. If you haven't before, are you gonna say hey? I got Fancy Nancy with me, y'all. Say hey. Anyway, so these are the tomatoes. This made my grow list. If you guys have some that y'all are adding, please leave a comment. I'd love to know what you guys are growing as well. So I'll talk to y'all soon.